Buenos Aires, the city on the motionless river. A cosmopolitan city. A city of intrigue, and tonight, of murder. And where will the murderer strike next? Inspector Eric Lundrot thinks he has divined a pattern. A pattern which will lead him to a quarter of the city not on any map, nor corresponding to any point on the compass. A pattern which will lead him through the vanishing point.
Room service. Room service. Anybody in the bathroom?
I think we're finished with the bathroom, Inspector.
All right. Do this room now.
Inspector, Lundrot is here.
Lundrot.
Hello, Merrick. Who's the gentleman with the knife?
Okay, boys, cover him up. His name is Marcel Yarmolinsky, Rabbi Marcel Yarmolinsky. He was here for some kind of convention.
For the Third Talmudic Congress.
Who are you?
I'm Schultz, Yazala Schultz. I'm with the Yiddish Zeitung. Rabbi Yarmolinsky was a delegate from Podolsk. I had an interview with him today.
Well, he won't be doing much talking now, so you might as well leave.
Who found him?
The maid, when she came in to make up the room. He was stabbed through the heart.
Ah, very classic. The silver blade did cleave my heart. The silver tongue cried out in pain. Did anyone hear anything?
Well, the Tetrarch of Galilee has a suite on the other side of the corridor. His chauffeur is in the room next door, but he says he didn't hear a thing.
The Tetrarch of Galilee? I didn't know such a thing existed.
It does, and it is rich. It owns the finest sapphires in the world. Our man must have tried to steal them, broke into this room by mistake, woke Yarmolinsky, and had to kill him. Murder by mishap.
Well, it's possible, but not very interesting. You'll say that reality is under no obligation to be interesting, maybe. Maybe reality can disregard that obligation. But in my modest opinion, theories may not.
What is your theory, Lundrot?
Well, Meyrink, here's a dead rabbi. I'd much prefer a rabbinical explanation.
I'm not much interested in rabbinical explanations. I'm interested in getting the man who killed this unknown party.
Not so unknown. All those books there on the table. Yarmolinsky's complete works. A Vindication of the Kabbalah. A biography of the Baal Shem Tov, founder of the Hasidic movement.
Take those books away and study them if you like, Lundrot. I can't waste time on a lot of Jewish superstitions.
Inspector!
What now?
This sheet was in the rabbi's typewriter.
Oh, you want to read it, Lundrot?
Yes, let me see. The first letter of the name has been uttered.
And what in God's name is that supposed to mean?
Good evening, Beth.
Dinner won't be a moment.
Aha!
Yes, sir.
So, your sister's been to see you.
My sister?
Soup. I smell soup, my dear. Soup. Means you had no time to cook the roast you promised and decided to heat the soup instead. Now, why would you not have time? Today is not washing day. That was yesterday, I know, because the sheets were changed. So, what could make our splendid Beth change her plans? A visitor, of course. A visitor who talks quite a lot and, aha, confirmation, an umbrella, a lady's umbrella. Obviously your sister's, and to forget it, equally obviously, she must have been here. Quod erat demonstrandum.
I saved the roast till Sunday because you said Inspector Meyrink would be coming to dinner. I reheated the soup because there's no point in throwing good food away. That's not my sister's umbrella. It's my old one, and it's on its way to the church bazaar.
Beth, you disappoint me. You always look at things in the simplest possible way. It's only a mask, the simple side of things. You should look behind the mask, Beth, behind the mask.
You want a glass of milk with your soup?
No, thanks. Beautiful soup, so rich and green, waiting on a hot tureen.
Shall I put your parcel on the desk?
Parcel? Oh, Yamalinsky's books. No, I'll look at them here.
More books? You'll get them covered in soup.
Mens sana in corpore sano, Beth. Keep your mind active while you eat. Nourish the spirit while you feed the flesh. Beth, do you ever think about the true name of God?
I didn't even know he had one.
Well, for the Jews, God has a secret name, a terrible name that cannot be uttered. And some believe that if it were ever pronounced, it would bestow upon you infinite power and wisdom. Ah, here. Listen. The ineffable, sacred, reverential, unknowable, and incommunicable name with which God is referred to some 6,000 times in the Old Testament is made up of four Hebrew letters. Yod, He, Vav, and He again. Uh-huh.
Would you like some more soup?
These four letters, called the Tetragrammaton, have a secret pronunciation. Do you realize the importance of this, man?
I thought you were working on a murder case.
I am, Beth, I am. The solution lies in these four letters. I know it. All I need is God's help to find it.
Nice, Watson, you found yourself Sherlock.
Acidic ritual. Yes. Anno Nafshoik Tovit. Yahovit. Wish I could understand Hebrew. That's it!
Now where are you going?
Out! Sometimes even an expert needs expert advice.
Yes?
Lundroth.
Who?
Chief Detective Eric Lundroth. Is that Schultz?
Yes?
Schultz, would you please let me in? There's something I want to ask you.
Push the door when you hear the buzz. Then it's the second door on the right.
Second door on the right.
Lundroth?
I see you're busy. But it's urgent.
It's all right. It's all right. Come in. It's always like this when Sarah's out. Maybe you wouldn't mind holding Sholem while I try to get the bottle warmed up.
I came to ask you a few questions. There, baby. A question about the name of God.
This heats up very quickly. Sholem hates it when his dinner's late.
I want to know about the Hasidim and...
I think it's all right now. Here, try it. No, I mean put it in his mouth.
Oh.
Good. Now we can sit down.
Where shall I put him?
Well, just anywhere, on the floor. Once he's got his bottle, he's fine.
Schultz, do you believe that uttering the name of God is the key to the powers of the universe?
Mr. Lundroth, maybe you're asking the wrong person. I'm an atheist. I'm the opposite of most Jews. See, most Jews believe in God but are not interested in his theology. I'm interested, but I don't believe.
Tell me what you know.
Well, perhaps the most important book of Jewish mysticism is the Sefer Yetzirah.
Oh, yes. Yarmolinsky translated it. I have his copy at home.
The Sefer Yetzirah opens with this sentence. By means of 32 mysterious paths did the Eternal engrave and establish his name and created his world.
32, eh?
Exactly. The 32 paths are explained as the 22 letters of the Hebrew alphabet, together with the 10 sephirot.
I see.
You do? Well, throughout the centuries, Jewish mystics have believed that because God made the world with 22 letters and 10 sephirot, what you would call creative writing, certain combinations of letters have a secret meaning, And the Tetragrammaton, the combinations of letters in God's name, is the most powerful of all.
And the Hasidim?
The Hasidim. The name means pious. Oh, much of their fame to the great Baal Shem Tov, who founded the Hasidic movement in the 18th century.
Yes?
The Hasidim are dedicated mystics, perhaps the most earnest seekers of the name. The Goyim spread rumors about bloody rituals that are supposed to be part of the search.
Exactly!
But, of course, very little is known of these extracurricular activities.
Schultz, you've been most kind, most helpful.
Oh, not at all.
You look after Sholem. I'll see myself out.
Details of that story are to be confirmed today. A man was stabbed to death last night in the western suburbs. Early this morning, the body of Daniel Simon Azevedo was found lying on the doorstep of a hardware store, with a knife still protruding from the chest. There is no indication as to the motive for this murder. Chief Detective Eric Lundroth has kindly agreed to join us today in the studio. Good morning, Mr. Lundroth.
Good morning.
Mr. Lundroth, it was reported that a message, a peculiar message, was found next to the body.
On the wall of the hardware store, to be precise. The wall was decorated with red and yellow diamond shapes, and someone, presumably the murderer, had written on them in chalk.
Are you at liberty to disclose the nature of the message, Mr. Lundroth?
As to the nature of the message, I'm not certain. The message itself, I can repeat. the second letter of the name has been uttered.
Uh-huh. And does that message convey any special meaning to you, Mr. Lundroth?
Everything conveys a special meaning. When we fail to grasp it, it is the eyes, not the object, that is to blame.
Of course. Mr. Lundroth, would you say that this was a gang murder, you know, disposing of an informer?
Journalists have a passion for the obvious. Look at the symmetry, at the pattern. Gangs are not renowned for their neatness, you know.
Yes. Well, thank you, Chief Detective Lundroth. We will be back after these messages.
Inspector Meyrink and that gentleman to see you, sir.
Meyrink, another little murder?
I'm not sure. Mr. Finnegan here has a story I think you'll find most interesting.
Black Finnegan. My pleasure, Mr. Lundroth.
Sit down. Akavit?
Well, I'll try anything once. I thank you kindly, sir. Indeed, I will.
Thank you, Beth.
Yesterday, February the 3rd, I got a call in the office. Oh, thanks. That's fine. Someone called Ginsberg.
Ginsberg or Ginsberg?
Ginsberg, with an S. Anyway, he said he had some information on the double sacrifice, as he called it, of Azevedo and Yarmolinsky.
You traced the call?
I thought it might be a practical joke, you know, with the carnival and all that. But yes, I had it traced. It came from a sailor's tavern, Liverpool House.
My ex-missus was a jury from Liverpool, if you know what I mean.
Yes.
I asked Mr. Finnegan if he remembered who had made calls that day. There's only one phone in the house, and that's in Mr. Finnegan's office.
Well, the only gentleman to use the phone yesterday was a Mr. Griffiths, a foreign gentleman.
Griffiths, Ginsberg.
Yeah, he'd been in the house for about a week. Paid the rent in advance. Oh, nice man. Quiet sort.
What did he look like?
He had a kind of misty gray beard, and he always wore black. Oh, he never went out. He had his meals in his room, like a real gentleman.
I take it your story does not end with the phone call.
Oh, all right you are, sir. A horse-drawn carriage pulled up outside. The coachman was dressed like a bear, with a mask and everything.
A bear?
Well, two harlequins got out, you know, in those costumes with diamond shades, red, yellow, green.
Diamond.
Yeah. They burst into the lobby, blowing silly red hot, and they wrapped their arms around Mr. Griffiths. But he seemed to know them.
But he didn't seem too pleased to see them.
When did they leave?
About 10 minutes later. With Mr. Griffiths. Oh, and hadn't Mr. Griffiths seemed as drunk as they were, you know? Hardly able to stand on his feet. Well, the Harlequins, they had to carry him out.
Well, I'm sure that's the last the world will see of Mr. Griffiths Ginsburg.
It all smells too cozy, too much like a plant. One of the Harlequins drew a dirty picture on the wall of Liverpool House and a crazy message. You'll never guess what it said.
The last letter of the name has been uttered.
Exactly. Now, how did you
Mayling,
ever...
I take it you inspected the room?
It's a small room. On the floor was a star-shaped bloodstain. The bed was unmade. There was a chair and a table. On the table were a pile of cigarette butts of a Hungarian brand and a half-eaten cheese sandwich. I think it was Edam. Oh. There was a suitcase with hardly any clothes in it and a book.
A book?
I thought you'd like to see it.
A Greek-Hebrew dictionary. Here's an underlined passage. Deus Judaeorum incipit a solis.
Would you mind translating that into Christian?
The Jewish day begins at sundown and ends the following sundown.
Very useful, Lundrod. I'll remember that for my next crossword puzzle.
You should not disregard every valuable clue you come across, Mayrink.
And is this the most valuable clue you've picked up in this case?
No, Mayrink. Far more valuable is one of the words Ginsburg used over the phone. Good morning, Beth.
There's a big envelope for you on the table.
Let's see the papers first.
The envelope looks important.
Important things will wait. It's the trivial things that vanish into nothingness. Aha! An exclusive interview with our friend Red Sherlock.
That murderer.
Now, Beth, you mustn't be ungrateful. Without men like Sherlock, I'd be out of a job. The fact that he's a murderer shouldn't cloud your judgment of his character. Here we are. Oh, for goodness. He says that in his part of town, he must mean the South, this sort of crime would never take place, and he accuses Inspector Mayrink of criminal negligence.
Sherlock probably killed them all himself.
Ah, no slander, Beth, no slander.
If you're finished with breakfast, how you can eat bread and cheese in the morning, I'll never know.
Thank you, Beth. Let's see this important envelope. Neat handwriting. Postmark, Trist-le-Roi.
Trist-le-Roi? That's in the southern suburbs. Horrible place.
A map. And a note. To Eric Lundrot. That's me. On the 3rd of March, there will not be a fourth crime because the Hotel de Noir... Ah, yes, the first crime is marked here on a map. The Hotel de Noir... The hardware store on the west side and Liverpool House to the east form the perfect sides of an equilateral and mystical triangle. It's marked in red on the map. Who signs this Euclidean note? Baruch Spinoza. Good old Jewish name. So, three equidistant points. Symmetry in space. And... symmetry in time. December the 3rd, the first crime. January the 3rd, the second crime. February the 3rd, the third crime. 333. In God's name!
Careful with it!
Beth, I've got it!
The murderer?
The murderer's mine! Where's the compass I had somewhere?
You're going safe.
Where is it?
Here you are.
And a ruler.
Here.
Good.
Why can't you hunt for clues in the fresh air like an ordinary detective? Oh, this cooped-up fiddle faff.
That's it! I have called Mayrink.
Inspector Mayrink.
Tomorrow, the murderers will be behind bars.
What?
We can take a rest.
Eric, so they're not planning a fourth murder?
But precisely because they are planning a fourth murder, we can rest easily.
Eric, Even when I understand you, I don't understand you.
Myth, I'm going south.
To Trice Leroy? Will you be home for dinner?
I will, Beth. I will.
Tetragrammaton. Sign genius. 1, 2, 3. Trice Leroy. Wouldn't Red Sherlock love to know I'm coming down his way? Sherlock the dandy. Does Fedo work for Sherlock? What if Sherlock himself were the intended fourth victim? No, that's absurd.
Next stop, Trice Leroy.
The universe is a beautiful pattern into which everything fits. After tonight, I'll go away. Nice, long rest. To the mountains, maybe. God, I'm ashamed I spent close to 100 days on such a simple problem.
Excuse me. How do I get to the old villa?
Oh, you don't want to go there.
Oh, I do want to go there.
Well, down the lane, across the field, behind those eucalyptus trees. You better hurry. It looks like rain.
Thank you.
Trice Leroy. God, this is a miserable place. Even the birds seem to have deserted it. Music. Where now? Two doors. All these insane repetitions. One balcony reflecting another. One statue matching another statue. Music seems to come from upstairs. Left or right? Let's turn right. Will this house never end? Another empty room. No. The house is not so large. The moonlight, the sameness, the mirrors, the loneliness make it large. You're old, Eric Lord. Locked. Sherlock.
You're very kind, Lonrot. You've saved me a night and a day.
Sherlock.
Take a seat, Mr. Detective. I'll switch on the light.
Sherlock, are you in search of the name of God?
No, Lonrot. I'm after something much more ephemeral, more frail. I'm after Eric Lonrot.
But why, Sherlock, why?
3 years ago, in a gambling dive on the Rue de Toulon, you arrested my brother. My men managed to get me away, but I had a bullet inside me.
I'm sorry to hear that.
9 days, 9 nights I went through hell here in this rat-infested villa wrecked by fever. I had endless nightmares about a house where everything was double, symmetrical. The reflection of something else. I came to loathe my body. I came to feel that two eyes, two hands, two lungs are as monstrous as two faces. An Irishman trying to convert me to the faith of Jesus kept repeating to me the saying of the Goyim, all roads lead to Rome. At night, my fever fed on that image. I felt the world was a maze from which escape was impossible, because all roads which seemed to lead north or south, in fact, led to Rome, which was also the cell where my brother lay dying, and also this villa of Trice Leroy.
Your brother was a killer. I only did my duty.
During those long nights, I swore by the gods of fever and of mirrors that I would weave a maze around the man who sent my brother to prison. Well, I've woven the maze. It's pretty tight. It's made of a dead rabbi, a compass, a Jewish superstition, a dagger, and the diamond-shaped patterns of a hardware store.
I admire your handicraft, but why kill a rabbi?
Poor Lonrod, you've discovered nothing, have you? The first victim, the rabbi, came to me by pure chance.
Chance?
With some colleagues of mine, among them Daniel Acevedo, I planned the greatest robbery of the century, the theft of the Tetrarch sapphires. Acevedo betrayed us, the pig. He got drunk on the money we advanced him and tried to pull the job a day earlier. But at the Hotel du Nord, he got mixed up. And around 2 in the morning, he blundered into Yarmolinsky's room.
But what about the message?
Yarmolinsky had been unable to sleep, so he decided to do some writing. Notes or something about the true name of God. He had just typed out the words.
The first letter of the name has been uttered.
Acevedo warned him not to move, but the rabbi reached for the buzzer.
And Acevedo killed him.
Good. You catch on quickly, Mr. Lonrod.
And how did this mistake inspire Sherlock the dandy?
The minute I realized you were guessing that the Hasidim had sacrificed the rabbi, I did my best to justify that guess.
Go on.
Yarmolinsky died the night of December 3rd. Mm-hmm. For the second sacrifice, I chose the night of January 3rd. Mm-hmm. The rabbi had died on the north side. So for the second sacrifice, yes, I chose a spot on the west side. Acevedo was the ideal victim. He deserved death. He was too impulsive. He was a traitor. To link his corpse with the previous one, I scribbled on the diamond shape of the hardware store the second message.
The second letter of the name has been uttered.
I hope I'm not boring you.
Absolutely enthralled. Please continue.
Many thanks. The third sacrifice was staged on the 3rd of February. I think our friend Myring guessed it was only a plant. Griffius Ginsburg...
Ginsburg.
Ginsburg was me. I spent an impossible weekend at Flea Hall in the Rue de Toulon wearing that false beard that was sheer torture.
I'm sorry.
Then, as planned, my friends came to kidnap me. One of them wrote on the wall the final message. The last letter of the name has been uttered.
Weather seems to be on your side.
A little atmosphere. It's been trying to rain all day. I think you met my expectations. You see, I knew it would strike you that a murder in the north, another in the east, and a third in the west, demanded a fourth murder in the south. The name of God, the Tetragrammaton, is made up of 4 letters. The diamond shapes on the hardware store and on the Harlequins also suggested 4. 4 sides, 4 angles, right?
Right.
Then the underlined section in the dictionary. The passage makes it clear that Jews reckoned the day from sunset to sunset, meaning that the murders had taken place on the 4th of each month. Again, the number 4.
And then, of course, you sent me the map with the note.
The last hint. I couldn't resist it. Was it too obvious?
Not at all.
I knew you'd realize that the triangle was really the upper part of a diamond shape. That in marking those 3 points, whoever had drawn the lines on the map was really marking a 4th point, the lower angle of the diamond. The point, of course, was here, at Tristlerwa.
Where death awaits me.
It took a lot of work and patience.
Not to mention a few lives.
But it was worth it.
Am I really worth it, Sherlock?
Most definitely, Lonrod. Most definitely. The rain. What are you thinking, Lundroth?
In our maze, there are three lines too many. I know of a Greek maze that has a single straight line. Along this line, so many thinkers have lost their way that a mere detective is sure to lose his way as well. Listen, Sherlock. When in another incarnation you hunt me down, stage or commit a murder in point A, then a second murder in point B, 8 miles from A. Then a third murder at point C, 4 miles from A and B, halfway between the two. Then wait for me at D, 2 miles from A and 2 miles from point C. Then you can kill me at D, just like you are going to kill me here, at Trislawa.
The next time I kill you, Lonrot, I promise you that maze made of a single straight line, invisible and unending.
Over, or has it just begun? For Inspector Eric Lunrot, there is still a mystery to solve. Who knows? When he meets Sherlock again, he may even have the advantage. For next time, perhaps, it will be Lunrot who lies in wait in the heart of the maze, on the other side of the vanishing point.